You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Going to be very antagonistic between me and
Alex. It sounds like you're in a mood, man.
Well, we're like a gay couple. This is what I've decided. I'm the bottom. I'm a power bottom, though.
They say that's who controls the action. They say.
Let me know when we're rolling, Alex. Are we rolling? We've been rolling. We've been rolling? Aren't you supposed to point?
I did.
I didn't see you point the finger at me. The middle finger, the middle finger doesn't count. Can you hold a pen in the future? And do that's it. I know it's it sounds pretentious. It looks pretentious to point a pencil at me to let me know that we're rolling. But that's what people do in professional show business.
Do you want me to slate myself?
Yes, please.
Joe DeVito appearing on the David Feldman podcast.
Are we actually rolling? Okay, I had to get my own coffee today.
What an insult. A man of your stature.
He is so over me.
I'm telling you. Finding good help.
He's just like, I walk into the studio, he's just, he's got bigger fish to fry. Joe DeVito joins us.
Hey. Are we rolling?
No, we're not. Until I see a pencil aimed at me.
Take 38.
Joe DeVito joins us. Thank you for coming back.
My pleasure. I had a great time last time.
You were amazing, and you... That toxoplasmosis stuff.
The toxoparasite, I love it.
You kind of explained a lot of stuff to me with that. I think it's true. I think some women, not men though, right? It doesn't...
In men, the toxoparasite encourages impulsive risk-taking behavior. So they find it in guys who die in motorcycle crashes a lot. They found they have toxo a lot.
Cats... This is cats who are doing this.
Yeah, it's from rats into cats and then back through that cycle again.
Cats are killing us. They're murderers.
Oh, that's what they do in so many ways. They wipe out wildlife. They're coming for us.
They have a parasite that they give to us as a gift, and it affects the way we perceive things.
Yeah, yeah. Through their turds, too, for the ultimate insult.
You're not making this up.
No, it's great stuff. It's great stuff. I try to pitch to a friend of mine a movie where the toxo parasite somehow merged with rabies, and that's how we got our zombie outbreak. And he was not in favor of that movie.
I find cats to be hysterically funny.
Oh, I love them.
I love cats. But you're playing with fire. They're dangerous.
Yeah.
They are capable of doing horrible, horrible things to us. Joe DeVito... is the Italian Andy Kindler. That's what I've
I'll
decided.
Take it.
You are the Italian Andy Kindler. And you opened for Andy, right?
Yeah, I've worked with him a bunch of times. That was one of the big thrills when I first got to meet him. You know how what fun it is when you meet the people when you're doing comedy? Like, oh, that's a guy that I looked up to. And of course, Andy is such a gregarious lunatic off stage too. So
he has a new podcast that's doing really well, Thought Spiral, that he does with J. Elvis Weinstein. Everybody should subscribe to it. It's fantastic. Let's talk about being Italian. Do you like my pronouncing it Italian?
I've come to terms with it. I can't say I'm a big fan. I notice that it seems to bring you a great deal of joy. So I've learned to live with it. Would you like directions to the Pizza Hut for something authentic?
When did you meet Andy Kindler? Because it is like talking to the Italian.
Should
Andy.
I be hunching forward as I deliver these punchlines?
But what I find interesting is that Andy sees himself in you. There's a bit of narcissism.
Really?
Well, he must, because you open for him.
Yeah, yeah.
So it means that Andy loves himself.
Could be.
Because if I saw myself in another comedian, I would try to crush the skull.
Yeah, exactly. I would see it as a threat.
Yeah, because I hate myself. But yeah. Andy obviously loves himself enough. He enjoys seeing himself on stage. How similar on stage are you to Andy Kindler? Because it does feel like I am talking to the...
I'd say a little bit. I mean, that's always the tricky thing when you find a comic that you like so much when you're first starting out to not mimic their style.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you see that with...
Did he have an influence on you?
I would say so, but I remember watching him way before I even thought of doing stand-up on Dr. Katz and thinking, oh, this guy's hysterical.
But that was a drawing of Andy. That
was... It was, but it was still his voice.
Right.
His voice. And the drawing,
you just know that was a cartoon. Right?
I didn't think he was squiggly through, through advanced Parkinson's that he recovered from. I met him actually at when I did Montreal in 2006 for New Faces, and he's an Omnipop guy, and my manager introduced me to him. That was really a thrill. That's what's pretty cool. There was one show I remember. Did you ever work comics when it was in Manhattan?
No.
It was on 14th Street, and... They booked a show. It was, listen to this show, it was me hosting, Maria Bamford in the middle, and Andy closing. And I just was thrilled.
Was that an Omnipop show?
No, it just happened to work out that way. And it was very interesting because as much as I love Andy, I know some people just, they don't understand what it he's doing on stage. And for the first three of the four shows, it was...
You're more likely to have Japanese businessmen get his jokes before middle America gets them.
Yeah, and it's interesting to watch a crowd at one of his shows because... A third of the room's laughing hysterically, a third is in and out, and a third is completely baffled. And you'll see different groups represented at the same table. So you'll think, oh, well, people have friends must have the same sense of humor. But yeah, three out of the four shows was people who came to see Maria and Andy or that kind of act. And I've been around. I can hold my own. But then the last show was just people came to a regular comedy club, which is my audience. I'm a road guy. And they liked Maria. They didn't quite understand her, but they liked her. And Andy, they just did not know what the hell was going on. And as much as I love Andy, there's something about watching when he's not doing well. It's a million times funnier than his regular set when he turns on the audience.
Well, yes. What's funny, that's I say this all the time on the show, that when I take a break from stand-up and come back to it, I always go into the kill zone until I realize... You're not supposed to kill. You're not a guy who kills. Your job is to not kill. It's funnier when a comic isn't killing.
It's more honest.
It's authentic.
Yeah.
It's a real human. It's dangerous. He's obviously not doing... If you're bombing, you're either not doing your tried and true stuff or you're telling the same jokes, but the act now... is in the moment because you're trying to figure it out.
You have no choice.
Yeah.
That's always the challenge. I find that lately it's a positive thing, although it's definitely some growing pains that, last week I did a show on a Saturday night. It was a fundraiser. And, the people on the way out tell me what a wonderful time they had. But the whole time I was on stage, I was thinking, what am I talking about? I don't give a shit about any of this stuff. And then the next night I went up and I just talked honestly about what's going on in my life and took some risks and all that, and it was infinitely more rewarding. Although there were some moments where even I was like, I have to do something to pull them back in now. But then they would, because even jokes that are jokes in my act, they now seemed different once I'd done that other stuff up front. I don't know if that explains it, but you know what I'm saying? Like once they were aware of me, oh, this is an act, this is an actual person. And that's the direction I want to eventually go in.
Is it fair to an audience to have material that they don't get?
Interesting. I think you have to respect the audience that...
Is it fair to have a reference to Gary Powers?
You don't want to have a reference that nobody gets, but I don't know. Are you opening for U2 at the moment? That's pretty intense.
That's
if you're able to...
a funny joke. I'm not going to laugh, but that's a funny joke.
Where I get nervous about...
It's a rainy day, and I'm kind of...
I appreciate it.
Yeah.
What I like is a reference that enough of the people in the audience get that the rest of the people are aware that something happened that they didn't understand.
So are you making the audience feel stupid? I'm not talking about Andy. I'm talking about referring to things that the audience, quote-unquote, should know. Is that fair to...
Well, that introduces a good variable to it, yeah. There are times where... I ended a show the other night, the crowd was so miserable, and I told my last joke, and I said, I'm not fucking explaining this joke to you people. And then that was good night.
But, so, when you get older, you become a grammarian. It's just, right?
I think you become more rules or rules. Because when you're young...
Go on with that.
Well, when you're young, you want to be a rebel. Mm-hmm. And old rebel's kind of pathetic. Because an old rebel, that's when you want to have a little stability. When you're young, you can be wild and reckless. And I think I even feel as I get older, rudeness and poor customer service make me insane. Even I think the heat, too, when it was really hot the other day, someone in front of me was walking too slow. And I had to resist the urge to hit them in the back of the head. And I don't think as a young man, I wouldn't even have been aware of the outrage of someone stepping too slowly in front of me. So I think when you get older, you do become, dare I say, a little bit more conservative in that way in your approach to things that you kind of like when people adhere to certain rules.
I'm a rebel, but I color within the lines.
Mm.
I'm all for, you know, I believe in the temple of democracy and having a common discourse where there are 435 congressmen and 100 mm-hmm. senators, and you use that framework to rebel and discuss and scream and argue.
Sure.
But you have to have the rules of the road. And it feels like there should be rules of the road when it comes to stand-up.
Well, again, I'm a road guy.
Yeah.
I dip my toe.
Are there rules to the road?
I think so, because...
What are the rules to the road? You don't steal jokes from people.
Absolutely not.
But even that now has become...
That'll always be around. Because there are just some people who... There's some people who getting the love from the audience at any cost is why they're in this.
But the rule is you don't steal from your fellow comedians.
No, you don't.
Even though the internet says...
Go for it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Talk to me about that for a second.
Well, the main difference I've noticed is that it seems like in New York City, there's much more an emphasis on you tried to do something. And if you didn't quite pull it off, that was still okay. If what do they say, your grasp exceeded your reach or whatever. Mm. Whereas on Long Island, where I do most of my work, people got babysitters, they paid for parking, they had dinner. You're there to deliver. You're not there, they don't give a shit about try. You're there to do. So I think you have to cross train a little bit, whereas you have to come to Manhattan to be creative and work on the new stuff. But everywhere outside, you have to respect them enough to try and give them some sort of a good show.
In Manhattan, you're playing at tourists.
Yeah. Well, it depends on what neighborhood you're in, too.
And the tourists tend to be forgiving, and yeah. they want you to try something.
Mm.
I have found in Manhattan that you could bring in the most racist, homophobic tourist, but they will be accepting of anything because, what the hell, I'm in New York City.
They're on your turf.
And they're saying, I want to experience New York City, so yeah. I'm going to be non-judgmental. I'm here to eat food that gives me diarrhea, and I'm here to...
Yeah.
Listen to material that would otherwise make my head explode.
But
in Long Island, this is my home.
Yeah, and you have to come through.
What are the rules to the road? As a comedian, how long have you been doing comedy?
This month is actually 16 years and full time since 2007.
What are the rules? Are there rules you... Because there were rules when I was starting out.
Do you mean on stage or like rules of conduct?
Rules of conduct in terms of on stage.
On stage, I would say, I guess because I was older when I started. You know, my young days, I had long hair and played guitar in bands, and I got all that crap out of the way then. So I never was tempted to be a party guy. So when I see guys go on stage drinking, it's bad.
Mm-hmm.
All the other weird tics.
Why is it bad?
Because it's disrespectful, I think. You're
to whom?
To the audience mm-hmm. and to the club. You're not there to party. You're there to work. If you, whatever substance abuse you want to do, you do that after the show. That's what I think.
But suppose it's part of my persona.
Drink apple juice.
Like Dean.
Like Dean did, yeah. Sometimes I'll go on stage with a glass of wine and I'll do a joke about it. But to me, I saw too many people I started with who thought because the shows were in bars, that meant you just got loaded and then they fell by the wayside.
Suppose you go on stage with wine
mm-hmm.
and do shots throughout your act and you continue to kill.
Well, good for you. Although I did learn about a great scam a friend of mine told me. She saw this headliner before the show, said to the wait staff, 5 minutes of my act, I'm going to tell a certain joke. When you hear it, come to the stage with a shot of whiskey. And when I ask you who it's from, say someone in the audience bought it for you.
Okay.
And we were like, well, what does this mean? Well, the guy's an alcoholic. So he tells his joke, gets a big laugh. Waitress comes with a shot of whiskey and he goes, oh, what's this? And she goes, someone in the audience bought it for you. And he goes, oh, you people are so nice. buying shots and sending them to the stage. Mm-hmm. So the audience wants to participate. Right. The whole rest of the night, they're sending shots to the stage. So the guy can barely stand by the time he's done.
Oh, wow.
And he didn't even pay for a single drink. He used his drink ticket for the one up front. So what a devious mind. Now, that's a comic who is not writing in a notebook. Uh-huh. You know, he's not coming up with new bits, but he figured out a way to game the system to feed his addiction.
There was a waitress at the Punchline. Her name was Kristen Stanley. This was like 20 years ago. And when I was headlining, I would work this out with her. I'd say, I'm going to ask you for a Greyhound. And then when you bring it to me, just as you're with the outstretched hand, I'm going to say, thanks, honey. And then just throw it in my face. And then just pretend there's some history between us.
Sure.
But it's not because I called you honey and it's sexist. There's something going on. Mm. And we did it a couple of times. It really freaked the audience out.
Sure.
I had to stop doing it because I think I was afraid it was going to hurt her tips. Because they were thinking, what happened between these two? Because I like not referring to it. I would just take a long pause, ask for a napkin, wipe my face down,
wow.
and just let the audience try to figure out, is she suing him? What is going on? But she had to go back to waiting on tables.
It
wasn't, it was funny for me, and she was willing to do it. And I realized, this may not be that funny.
I think audiences like surprises, but they don't like something unresolved like that. They don't like, because then how could they focus on the rest of your jokes after that?
Well, yeah, but I always, you mix it up. When you're bored on stage, you want to mix it up. So the rule is you don't steal. You don't go on stage drunk.
Obviously, things like respect the light, don't go way over your time.
There used to be a rule I was told, which I don't buy into because Andy Kindler's made a career out of it. You don't acknowledge a joke didn't go over. Keep going. Keep going. That was one of the rules. Have you ever heard that rule?
I've heard of it in the sense that there's some guys who their whole act is savers.
Mm-hmm.
And at a certain point, it always made me think, just write better jokes. And don't have to talk about how your jokes are bombing all the time.
Right.
But what Andy does is a deconstruction, so that's different. Yeah.
So what do you do when you're bombing?
Usually, I try to not get too deep into my own head about it. One of the things that's...
Do you define a bomb? Do you say, this is a bomb? Or do you say, well, it's second show Friday night?
I will rarely admit to bombing on stage.
To yourself?
To the audience.
What about to yourself?
Yeah, I'll know, like, oh, this isn't good.
How do you define a bomb?
I would say, I'm pretty free.
Is a subjective thing, or can it be measured?
I think it's a feeling of, what I do is not right for this audience. And I don't look at it as, they're stupid. Someone, I don't remember who said it, but the idea that, well, if you're so smart and they're so dumb, you figure out how to make them laugh. And I think there's a lot of truth in that.
Is bombing existential? I think it's existential in that you define it yourself. You can actually be bombing and then move the goalpost and decide it's a kill.
Well, I'll agree.
It's up to the comic to decide whether or not he's bombing or she.
I think it's definitely become an existential experience. There was one time I was on stage at Dangerfield, which is not an easy club, and it was 20 minutes of eating shit. And you really start to think, you go beyond, this isn't going well, to my whole life's a fraud. How could I ever think I was going to pull this off?
Yeah.
And then you come off stage and someone goes up and is doing the arms behind the back bit with someone from the audience, and then you're like, well, the hell with these people if they're going
to. But it's up to you to decide.
Sure.
I was on stage the other night eating shit, and it just went on and on and on. And I thought, you know what? I'm full. I'm going to put this shit away. Maybe I shouldn't be eating shit on stage.
Gorging yourself.
On shit.
No, you're making a pig out of yourself.
I do think even this podcast is existential because people will criticize it and say, why are you doing this? Why are you doing that?
Yeah.
And I'll go, I like doing this. I still want to have this guest on the show. Don't listen.
Yeah, no one forces anyone.
No, and I think the same applies to stand-up. I've watched a lot of comics not get huge laughs, but because they decided it was going well, they were killing.
And they turned it around?
or they weren't going by the laughs.
Huh. Interesting.
There are certain comics who don't define themselves by the level, the decibel levels of their laughs.
I could see that. See, I usually see that in the negative of the person who goes up in tanks and then comes off stage and they're so delusional. They think they have laugh ears. They think they killed.
When you're on the road, you have an opening act.
It, usually a local guy. I don't, I'm not in a position to bring people.
Are you measuring the decibels? If you, before you go on, do you determine?
I'll listen mostly to hear, oh, do we have any things in common? If we have common topics, then I try and make my adjustment. I'm either going to drop the block of material or think, oh, so-and-so talked about this, and here's what I have to say about it. But what I've learned is when I first started to work the road was 2008. And at that time, if I was closing outside New York, the middle act was an established road guy, and the MC was the funniest guy in town. And then, of course, as soon as I started getting paid, the economy collapsed, which I took personally. And then that meant because the budgets got cut, the MC, the funniest guy in town, is now the middle, and the guy who won the open mic contest is now hosting.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes they sit through 40 minutes of pretty bad comedy before I would go up. So sometimes it's good. They have soft expectations, but other times they're watching a shitty show, and you feel bad for them, and they look at you a little suspiciously when you go up.
Right.
And then you have to – I find in that situation, I try to say something funny as fast as possible so they can go, oh, thank God, and then they relax.
I'm thinking of a Dickens soft expectations small penis joke. I'm sorry. Forgive me. What would you rather have, a lot of laughs or a couple of really big ones?
Depends on the nature of the laughs. If it's something honest, if it's a joke that I think is really funny, I'll take the few big laughs as opposed to killing with stuff that I don't really care about. I mean, it depends where – like when I work family resorts and stuff where I have to work clean – I go heavy on Italian stuff or Italian material, as mm-hmm. it's also known. But I like the jokes I've written about it, but I don't particularly feel a compulsion to talk about lasagna and family dinners.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I'd rather be up and down talking about depression or suicide or something like that, like the things that I'm actually thinking about. So I know that those kind of laughs will go in and out, but when they hit, there's an extra resonance to them.
It's so interesting when you're saying playing family resource. When I was starting out, I thought... Yeah, I'm in my early 20s. If I could just put on a tux, I'm serious,
yeah.
And go on a cruise and play family resorts and play Vegas and have that kind of act, I would be so happy. But I never wrote an act that would allow me to do that.
There's still time.
And people have said to me, well, you'd be cursed then because you'd be spending the rest of your life playing cruise ships and family resorts in Vegas. I think, how is that a curse?
I think as long as you're not wishing you were somewhere else. I know when I do those kind of shows, I look at them as a challenge to say, how can I be me and express myself in a way that works within these constraints? And there's a pleasure in that.
There's a censorship on cruise ships.
Sure.
And family resorts. I always say, well, what's offensive now? How do you define... inappropriate for a family.
To be honest with you,
everything's inappropriate now. Everything that makes somebody laugh. I actually sent Brian Kiley, the great comedy writer / comedian, a joke today. I texted him. I said, is this funny? Somebody must have done this. And the joke is, I've been divorced for 10 years, but I still send my wife a box of chocolates every Friday because she's a diabetic. I said, now somebody must.
Joke.
Huh?
That's a fine joke.
That I thought, the only problem with that joke is I hate my wife. I'm trying to think, and that's like from the 50s. So that joke is.
But if
you like that joke? You love, but you're, how old are you?
But I love Borscht Belt.
It is Borscht Belt-y, right? So I just went.
But it's not wrong. You can certainly hate your wife in 2017.
But that's a cliche. And so Brian Kiley, who's a saint when it comes to comedy, wrote back, you're probably going to piss off women.
Yeah.
And I wrote back, hello, I'm David Feldman, pisses off women. So, but is that offensive? Could you do that at a family resort?
I wouldn't do that joke there, But I'm more concerned about saying something that's going to piss people off in a comedy club than I am in a family resort.
I'm interested. Let's go down the family resort because I'm interested in this. Because it's a type of censorship that's different or maybe close to the kind of censorship that's going on with Kathy Griffin. And now Eliza Schlesinger has taken to Twitter and Facebook to ask women to stop talking about their vaginas. And then Felicia Michaels, who I have to have on the show again, wrote a very conflicted piece for Tango about women talking about their vaginas. Since no women are here, I think you and I should...
We can probably work this topic over to...
And decide whether or not women should talk about their vaginas. So if there are any female comics listening...
Listen up, ladies.
Listen up, because Joe and I are going to tell you...
Pencils out. of your vaginas... I think it's a very – I don't even call it censorship. When I – this is what makes me laugh. This one particular resort I work at, there are times where I show up and they'll say, oh, just so you know, tonight's ages 7 and up and not ages 10 and up. And I laugh because I think, what adjustment do you think – how finely calibrated do you think the act is?
Who's Milton Bradley?
They're never going to get the 8-year-olds. I'm going to lose them. But I like going there because to me, I look at it as if I were to have a
conversation – Did they really say that to you?
Yeah.
Well, hold it for 1 second. What is the difference between a 7-year-old and a 10-year-old?
In terms of what I do? Absolutely nothing.
Right.
But I look at it as...
By the way, Gary Glitter used to say that as well. Go ahead.
That's terrible.
Yes, it is.
I look at it as they've hired me. They know who their audience is. They have to respect that, and I respect that as well. I look at it this way. I can.
You
always...
really offended me, mister. I'm only 7.
Well, I did have...
I mean, my older sister, she's 10. She was
she's
okay.
She's cool with it, but
but I'm
come
only
on.
7.
Nobody plays Twister anymore. That's weird. Where are your pants? I look at it as just if I were to speak... If someone were to introduce me to their grandmother, I would speak to them as myself, but in a different way than if they introduced me to their son or...
Well, you'd probably be talking a lot louder.
I would, to that big horn she's holding in her ear. I find it more of a concern in the clubs because I don't know what it is people
My
get
grandmother
bent about.
Was so deaf she had to put the horn in her ass.
To speak or to fart?
I was going for an enema joke, but you, I think that's better. Hang on. Go ahead.
I'll give an example of a joke I do in the clubs.
That was just... Can we edit that out? I know we go live to tape.
That's
can
okay.
We just edit it? Huh?
Yeah.
But it wasn't funny.
Yeah. The good news is we haven't even started recording yet.
It was a joke about my... Hang on. I'm sorry. Hold that thought for 1 second. It was a joke about my beloved grandmother putting an ear horn in her ass. Why? Can we take that out, please? It's a horrible... Okay.
He's actually holding up a pencil now, but stabbing it into the side of his neck. Here's a joke I tell in the clubs. I talk about... women being dishonest with the online dating and when they brag about their kids.
Mm-hmm.
And the joke is the woman says, mother of a great son. And I say, well, I'll be the judge of that. And the follow-up is, besides, if the kid's so great, why did his dad leave?
Mm-hmm.
And what I've learned is sometimes I'll tell that. It gets a groan.
Right.
But if I pause and take a very long sip of my drink and look at them, wow, that gets a huge laugh.
Wow, because they're there.
They're realizing, oh, this guy's not messing around. Now, that's a kind of joke other comics think is hysterical.
Right.
But you have to be – if you tell a joke in just the comics and back laugh, usually you have to think, what have
but
I done?
I think it's amazing. That's what makes it so thrilling is that you take a sip of water and you get a laugh off that. And you could never have written that without doing the joke.
There's no way I could have written a joke where I would have thought, and now here's where I take a sip and that gets a laugh. There's no way you can't reverse engineer jokes that way.
Okay. So what is too offensive for – a cruise ship.
Well, the ships, I don't know. I know that with this family resort...
Because here's my complaint.
Okay.
That people who claim to be family comics are rapists. Bill Cosby could play a cruise ship.
Sure. Vince Champ.
Yes.
A pretty prolific rapist, too.
Well, they don't know who Vince Champ is.
Vince Champ was a college comic who used to rape the college women.
And do you know what he finished with? The rape with?
No. Was it the hands behind the back bit? Please tell me it wasn't.
No, this is... I'm ashamed to tell you this because... It's really creepy. He used to finish his rape with "Pray for me."
Oh God!
And there. All right.
I heard he got caught because a woman heard his voice on the radio doing promo, and they recognized the voice. So yeah, and there was a squeaky clean, almost like a preachery type act. So
you mean like Bill Cosby?
Well, Bill Cosby was lecturing people on their morality,
right?
And we'll see. Good thing that's all resolved. But it's interesting to hear the divide on that. I was in a doctor's office.
There's a divide on Bill Cosby?
There's a divide. Older black women support Bill Cosby.
Huh?
I was listening to them talk about it, and these older black women were like, these women coming out after all these years, they're just trying to get money. And I thought, oh, this is interesting. Hmm. And I also knew, better keep my little mouth shut, because the chances of me saying something wrong here are about 150%.
Yeah, it reminds me of the OJ verdict, where we didn't understand why African-Americans were cheering. Is Frank Conniff here? So are we going to take a break? Oh, hey, Frank. You sit at the head of the table. I love your T-shirt, the trip to the moon, from the Earth to the moon.
Yep.
Frank Conniff is here. Hi.
Hey.
I would have sent you a car.
I prefer to walk.
Frank Conniff.
I don't want to be beholden to David Feldman for a lift.
Do you know the Italian Andy Kindler?
We've met at Eastville once before.
Hey, hi, how you doing?
Let me do the introductions. I'm not going to introduce Frank Conniff because he needs no introduction. He needs a cup of coffee.
I've got a Mexican Coke. I'm fine, thank you.
That sounds like a sexual act.
Mexican Coke.
The old Mexican Coke.
It has.
That was a scandal with Contafloss in the 20s.
Virginia Rappe. Mexican. Little fatty Arbuckle reference. So, Joe DeVito is Andy Kindler's favorite comedian.
Well,
next to you.
Yeah.
Joe DeVito opens for Andy, and have you ever met him before?
Andy Kindler, yes, many times.
Have you ever met
once before?
Yeah,
I know the name, of course.
So think of Andy Kindler, drained of all his Judaism. This is Joe DeVito,
and replaced with a Pomodoro sauce, a fine marinara.
Well, Joe DeVito came on the show last week, Frank Conniff.
Mm-hmm.
May I just tell you how much, how glad I am. How glad I am to see you.
I'm glad to be here. I came on the show last week too, but you just never saw me.
What show?
This show. I showed up last Saturday because I thought I was supposed to be here.
Me too.
Yeah.
But then Alex said no.
Mm-hmm, right.
Oh, wait a second. Alex made a mistake?
No, I made a mistake. He told me the right date, but I assumed it was that coming Saturday.
Oh. Alex is just really messing up today. You know how Jackie the Joke Man would write jokes for Howard?
Uh-huh.
Alex just told me to do a joke about putting an ear horn in my grandmother's anus.
Oh.
So she could fart louder. And I told it because I trust Alex's instincts.
Mm-hmm.
We've been getting a lot of calls about it.
We've been getting a lot of
calls.
Cats. What is the name of your new book?
My book is called Cats v. Conniff, and it's about my cat suing me for defamation of character. Because I, if you follow me on social media, you know that they're the stars of my social media feed. Barney and Millie, and I exploit them. And they finally had enough, and they took me to court. And this book is a chronicle of that whole thing that everybody already read about in the papers.
Yeah. It's like a Corey Feldman kind of situation.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
You know, I did read about it in the papers.
Uh-huh.
But there is insight now because enough time has passed after the trial.
Right.
You're giving your version.
I'm giving a straightforward version of what happened.
You are a cat person still.
Yes, I'm a dog person too, but just living in the city, I haven't had dogs. So in my adult life, I really haven't had dogs. I grew up with them.
All right, I'm going to ask you a serious question because I remember this vividly.
Mm-hmm.
You were sitting on your bed reading.
Mm-hmm.
This was about a year ago.
Uh-huh.
And Barney, for no reason, clawed your hand.
Yeah, he actually did that last night too. When I was sleeping, he just attacked my foot, and I'd been away for a few days, so I don't know if that had anything to do with it. But
and you said, "Fuck you, Barney." I remember this vividly. You just said, "Fuck you, Barney." I want to know if he understood. Fuck you, Barney.
He understands if I yell at him that I'm upset. That he does understand that. I think maybe he takes him a while to figure out what I'm upset about, but he'll, like, you know, run away and stuff if I yell at him.
Joe DeVito, tell him about toxoplasmosis.
I'm a huge fan of the toxoparasite. We talked about that last time, the one that's passed on through the cat feces to the rats, and pregnant women have to avoid it and all that, and the psychological effects.
And I've heard that someone told me the other day that everything in our homes are what give cats liver problems. That all the toxins in our homes, if you have a house cat, that's how they get liver problems.
Well, I thought it was from the drinking.
I was just going to go with that. I was going to
scotch.
Well, that too.
But, meow mix.
As you know, what it's okay to give them scotch. Don't give them Brandy Alexander's because it's the milk that's bad for them. Yeah, and also chocolate.
They can't eat chocolate, cats.
Well, dogs can't eat chocolate. I don't know if this is true with cats, but I know it's true that it's really bad to give a dog chocolate.
Yeah. But cats don't really like sweet stuff usually.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Dogs eat anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Once you've crossed the eating your own shit barrier, I think you really can't get too fussy with the rest of the menu.
Right, right. I've eaten my own shit many times in this business.
When my dog Cody used to lick my son's face, I used to say, "He'd go, he loves me." I'd say, "No, he misses the taste of his own shit."
Now those are the memories. That's a real cats in the cradle moment for your son right there, huh?
Why do you like cats? Seriously.
Well, I like animals in general, and cats are...
How do people buy your book, by the way?
They can get it at Amazon. It's in paperback on Kindle. And very soon at Whole Foods, it'll be available. and also, when I do my live shows, I merch the shit out of all of it. Trace Blue and I do our live, the Mads are back. Movie riffing show. We have a table set up in the lobby before and after the show, and we just sell all our stuff. I have another book too that I also sell. So
that
book is called 25 Mystery Science Theater Films That Changed My Life in No Way Whatsoever. So that my merch table is my store, really. That's where I do most of my business.
Outside shows, I just have a coffee can. and an empty guitar case. There's no guitar, but they can feel
that
free
works.
To throw in any buttons.
As long as you have some kind of merch to sell.
What do you think of Amazon now putting all these mom and pop monopolies out of business?
It's just an unfortunate aspect of the world we live in, of so many stores getting put out of business, and it's really a shame. I mean, remember how we always used to be oh, Barnes & Noble, Borders, they're evil corporate. Go to the mom-and-pop bookstores, which is true. You should go to mom and... But now the mom-and-pop are the only ones that have survived. But now, don't you miss the days when there were Barnes & Nobles all over the city?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know?
When you see an empty Borders now, I'm always amazed by how they're all the size of a penitentiary.
Uh-huh, yeah.
They really bit off more than they could possibly have chewed.
Yeah, and so I think... You know, and record stores and bookstores and all that stuff has just become a specialty thing now. And, you know, it hurts the culture of a city that you live in, you know, because, on the one hand, everybody now can have an entire library of classic films on their phone or on their iPad or on their computer, but now there's no Bleecker Street Cinema anymore. Yeah. There's no Talia Theater. There's no, you know, the Theater 80 that used to show movies. Things were just a part. When I grew up in New York, those were such a part of New York culture. If you wanted to see a classic film, you went out and you saw a double bill at the Carnegie Hall Cinema or at the Bleecker Street Cinema or at the New Yorker on the Upper West Side. And now it's great that you can see all those movies much easier now, but the presence of those things in a city, in a neighborhood, really enhance the culture of the geography of the place, and that's it's a shame that all of that has gone away.
You used to be a boulevardier.
A boulevardier.
You were flaneur. I remember you would put a flower in your lapel,
uh-huh.
and you'd have a walking stick.
I would, because of my, but that was because of my gout.
and you would just walk the streets of Manhattan.
Which I still do. I still am what you would call a
boulevardier.
A flaneur. I still walk the streets. And then walking the streets of New York is still really great. But if you grew up in New York like I did, there's ghosts of things everywhere. Everywhere you go is a ghost of something that used to be that isn't there anymore, but is now a Pinkberry. Now, Pinkberries are gone, too.
Is Pinkberry going out of business?
Most of them have left. There's a couple of them. Because now you can eat yogurt digitally.
It's delivered by drone right down your throat.
Oh, I was saying, like, you're like me, you eat with your hands. The problem with New York is a lot of retail space now is empty.
Yeah.
They can't afford the rents.
Right. And the rents are exorbitant.
The rents are exorbitant. So the city is becoming empty for us flaneurs and our boulevardiers. I put on my three-piece suit and put the flower in my lapel and went to, like, the Paramus Mall to be a flaneur and a boulevardier.
They do have a rule about spouting verse at the Paramus Mall, though. Do you not? They ask you kindly, but the third time you have to leave.
And those are becoming empty as well.
Yeah, it's, you know...
Is it all Jeff Bezos? Is it all Amazon that's doing it?
Not all him, but he's a big part of it. And, you know, he's just on one hand, he's just a guy who started a business and it's successful.
Really? Are you that forgiving?
But I'm just like, we can't stop change. You know, we can't stop the world we live in is the world we live in.
That doesn't sound like the Frank Conniff.
We can't make it go back to we can't take all the we can't take the internet away and make it go back to the way it was before.
This sounds like the new Frank Conniff, who's been on the road making money and part of the 1%.
That's what my I wish my agent would just take 1%. But
you don't think we should break up? I honestly believe.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of, you know,
I think we
in my
break
heart
up
of
Jeff
hearts,
Bezos.
I don't think he should be one corporation should be able to own, and that's like been really devastating in, as you know, in the world of television and movies and news, you know, that one corporation could, it used to be if you had a newspaper, you couldn't have the TV station, you know,
right.
Or vice versa. Rupert Murdoch changed all that. He had special rules made for him so that he could buy the New York Post when he'd already.
Right.
And then so he could buy the local station. So that's
I think it was the Boston paper, not the New York
maybe,
Post.
But he did buy the New York Post. I remember that. And, I don't think that's a good thing at all. I don't think networks should be allowed to own studios. And it was better before when the studio would try to sell their stuff to a network as opposed to being a production company that's part of the network. You know, that's just, you know, about 20, 30 years ago, that kind of deregulation became okay. And the conservatives just want more of that.
The reason I think in my new book I'm going to be writing about the Sherman antitrust law.
The Peabody and Sherman antitrust?
Yes, where you go back in time.
Yes.
Quiet you.
And you buy up companies before anybody knows they're going to be successful, and then you have a monopoly. The Sherman antitrust laws were, I believe, and this is the theory of my book, came about because of Darwin. Because Darwin explains that in evolution, things in motion stay in motion. It's Newtonian. I have just confused everybody. But nobody knows what the fuck I'm talking about right now, including me. What I'm saying is there's a reason antitrust legislation started in the early 1900s, because you understood evolution. And what evolution teaches us is things in motion stay in motion. A powerful animal, not stopped, will devour everything. Mm-hmm. For the T-Rex will eat everything. The human being will destroy everything unless you put impediments. That's the nature of evolution. So when you say Amazon will eventually stop by its own, no. Once this thing starts, it's Newtonian. It just stays in motion, and Jeff Bezos will gobble up.
It seems like that's his...
He will gobble up everything. Mm-hmm. The only reason Microsoft didn't gobble up everything is because of the threat of antitrust violations.
Yeah.
I think Google, you know, thank God for the EU, because they're going after Google. They have to be broken up. They have to be.
I think Bezos' mistake was posing in that giant mechanical Iron Man suit. Did you see when he did that at some conference? He posed, he was inside a giant mechanical exoskeleton moving around. Mm. And we don't really need to see you as a mad scientist superhero like that. Let's use our imagination. And I think that was kind of terrifying to think, oh, that's a comic book guy actually taking over the world, walking around inside a giant robot.
I'm going to be quiet, Alex. I promise. He said, don't tell me you're going to be quiet. Just be quiet. This is my theory that I'm working on for my book.
Mm-hmm.
The reason we allow, and then I promise, but I want your reaction to this. The reason we allow Amazon to be a monopoly and Google to be a monopoly is because they're American companies. And it's the same reason we spend $500 billion a year on defense, because we say if we don't spend this money, another country is going to come along and spend all this money on defense, and we'll no longer be the most powerful. And we've now transposed that to our economy, where we say, well, we have to have Amazon be this bulldozer because some other country will create an Amazon and they'll get all the business. We use other sins to justify new sins. The sin of $500 billion on defense now is used to justify allowing Google and Amazon and Apple to be monopolies, because we have to protect the American economy, even though these three companies don't pay any taxes. Mm-hmm. I'm done. Thank you. Goodbye. Mm-hmm.
And also, they employ relatively few people compared to how big their companies are.
But if we don't do it, somebody else is going to do it.
The reason people are okay with Amazon is not because of what it does for the economy, because it makes it easy to buy shit, you know?
Yeah, they are pretty amazing. I have that Amazon Prime. It's the closest you can get to thinking of something and then having it show up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
My friends make fun of me. I get toilet paper from Amazon. I tell them, by the time I get myself to the store, I actually do anything, I could just click something and it shows up.
By the way, and full disclosure, the listeners of this show know that one of the ways to help me is by doing all your Amazon shopping via...
Right.
Oh, you're an affiliate, huh?
I'm an affiliate, and it's a great way to help out the show. I get a monthly check from Amazon. I don't know who the people are who are shopping.
Hmm.
I don't know what they're buying, but a little money comes in. And so...
And also, I'll say another thing about it is it's enabled a person like me to go into business for himself, because I publish my books on CreateSpace on Amazon, and it's just a really great way to get my stuff to the public, you know.
Well, defend Amazon, then.
I'll just defend it on that level, but anything you're saying about how wrong it is for it to be so huge and to have its fingers into everything and to have a monopoly, I'll agree with. You know, but I'll publish my books through CreateSpace, and I'll watch movies on Amazon Prime, you know, and I'll buy every book I have. I have like 100 books in my pocket at this moment in my iPhone that I buy off of, that I get on Kindle.
So
on the Kindle for iPad. So I'm supporting two corporations. I'm supporting Amazon, and I support Apple, which is also evil. I support them like crazy. I have like three of their devices that I'm completely reliant on.
Is the answer to see them as a utility that provides infrastructure for entrepreneurs like you?
It can be. You know, there is positives to it, but... It is a dangerous thing, though, you know.
It's dangerous. They will say it's creative destruction. Mm-hmm. They'll say, we're mowing down the mom and pop bookstores to free up
right.
the entrepreneurial spirit. So somebody like Frank Conniff
right.
can...
And the thing about it, what it does for me, too, is because I'm able to take the initiative and put out my own stuff, I'm not reliant on the gatekeepers yeah. of the entertainment industry to give me permission to have a body of work. Now, I can go out and have a body of work just because I put in the work to do that. I don't have to go through a bureaucracy like we all do in TV and with studios where there's a whole bunch of red tape. If you have any kind of idea that you're trying to get out and if you're trying to entertain the public, there's this whole bureaucracy you have to go through. Now I don't have to go through that bureaucracy. I can just put the stuff out there and promote it on my own and see what happens.
That part's pretty great because I yeah. think of bands that I love from, you know, 70s and 60s that because they never got a record deal, their canon doesn't exist. You just can't find it anywhere. There's a band I love called Sonic's Rendezvous Band. It was Fred Sonic from the MC5. Mm-hmm. And they pretty much released one single. So anything
MC5
else.
MC5, Pump Up the Jams?
Kick Out the Jams, yeah. Yeah, and it's...
Oh, I'm thinking Pump
you're thinking
Up the
of Technotronic.
God damn you for knowing that.
But yeah, so there was like a great band like that, and you have to hunt around for these bootlegs right. and stuff, whereas now everyone just records it themselves and puts it online themselves.
So. And then it's out there, and then...
How much of this is a myth? I was watching an author, a British author, who says Google and Amazon and Apple are selling the myth of entrepreneurial endeavors when in fact they're just sucking up all the money.
Well, I'm sure they are just sucking up all the money. But I don't know if I may, you know, my whole career has been based on self-delusion, so I may be deluding myself to think that I have some control over my work, but it feels that way to me, you know. But I'm also lucky because I have a following that, like, I have an audience that I can market my stuff to, you know, so I have a leg up that way. It certainly seems to me like I'm taking things into my own hands, and I'm expressing my
creativity. I'm not talking about Pornhub. I'm talking about that's a whole other thing. Right.
It's the most democratic place on right. the internet.
How are you on time? If I get you an Uber to...
Yeah, I got like 5 minutes, five, 10 more minutes.
You can't
minutes.
Stay for a little longer?
I got to catch you a train. My
socks I love
are
this
wet.
Guy.
Mm-hmm.
And he's leaving us.
Mm-hmm.
I blame the weather.
Are you catching the Amazon train?
I actually have a drone takes me back to Long Island.
Yes.
Just drops me on the LIE. I have to fend for myself from there.
The way I understand you, Frank, this mm-hmm. is, and you are a recipient of this new economy. You, mm-hmm. You've been a beneficiary of this new economy mm-hmm. in that when we first met, you were a comics comic.
Mm-hmm.
You were living in L.A.
Right.
And then is it fair to say you took off on Twitter and Facebook?
I don't know if I ever took off. I think just in the sense that other comedians have developed a following for their jokes. You mm-hmm. know, I'm one of those people. There are yeah. a lot of comedians with much bigger followings than I have. But
your following is based purely on the jokes you write.
Well, on Twitter, yes, I would say. I think I started with a base of like nerds and Mystery Science Theater fans and comedy nerds. But I've built up my following, which is at this point is about 65,000, which, you know, compared to John Fugelsang, who has 250,000, or Patton Oswalt, who has 3 million or whatever. It's not much, but it seems... a lot to me because I've really literally built it up one joke at
right,
a time,
right.
you know, and it's great. What I love about it is it just gives you an audience for jokes that you mm-hmm. write. And so like when I go and do shows, people, you know, when I go to do Mystery Science Theater related shows, people come up to me and they're fans of Mystery Science Theater, but then they also say, oh, I love your Twitter. Oh, I love your Facebook page. And for a comedian who's trying to reach the public somehow, you know, that feels good, you know.
Especially since it's an opt-in. They're people who get you.
Huh?
They're people who understand what it is you're trying to
do.
Yeah,
yeah. And then there's other people, and they troll me every day who hate what I do, you know. But but the people who like it are kind of the more positive.
You're an example of the cream rising to the top. But does everybody...
I do enjoy cream. You're like...
Is
you're
it
right.
fair? Is it fair that only the cream can survive? I mean, what if...
The cream rises to the top, which is why Chris Christie bought a stepladder. He's a large man.
Is it fair? What about but the... In other words, we...
Nothing is fair.
Yeah, life you got to let that go.
Life is not fair. Show business certainly is not fair.
So what happens to the people who can't move up in a meritocracy?
I only know about comedy, but I think in any business, there are people who don't move up for whatever reason, and there are people who fall by the wayside, and... I think in terms of comedy, it's all about just sticking with it and not giving up, you know, despite the many setbacks that I've felt I've had through the years and the disappointments and the feeling of utter rejection that you go through in this business.
I had utter rejection. My mother wouldn't breastfeed me.
I know. That's the worst. But I had utter rejection. Because they didn't find me attractive, but
I thought it was a Animal House.
Yeah, they were not breaking up seashells on their chests.
Yes, I was telling someone the other day that I think I finally sort of think of myself as a success only because I'm still doing it. You know, I'm 60 now, and I still am just. Kind of like I was when I was in my 20s, where I just had all still like looking towards things, coming up with ideas for things, coming up with projects, doing shows, being a part of comedy, which I've always wanted to be a part of, and I'm still a part of it. So that feels like I've achieved something just by the very fact that I'm still doing it.
The gatekeepers. I was talking to a comedian who is on par with you guys. Unbelievably talented, just and respect. I'm not going to mention the name. And he said, well, it's just a given that because of my age, Hollywood isn't going to touch me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'd agree with
that. I think that's true.
There's also all that watermelon smashing he does. I think it's a little dated.
Yes, that's true. What is this ageism about?
I don't know. I think it's completely, it's just a thing people have made up. In their minds, because you're like me. You perform in New York comedy clubs, and it's always a millennial audience. It's always like a really young audience.
I don't feel ageism.
And once you get up there, and once you say something that makes them laugh, then they're like, "Oh, this guy's funny." No one in the audience is going, "Oh, this guy has gray hair. I'm not going to laugh at him unless I'm not making them laugh with my material." You know. And so once you're laughing, it's there's no prejudice at all. You're just once you think something's funny, you're gonna laugh. And I've seen really blatant examples of people who should know better, like saying really ageist stuff about comedians who get past their freshness date, and you know, and.
But what is the mistake people our age can make? To create a jism.
A jism?
No, we're talking...
That's if they're lucky. That's actually if they're able to pull that off.
I don't get it.
It's a lot of D vitamins.
I don't know what you're talking about. I'm talking about ageism in this business.
I think it's people who have not... Even though they've gotten older, but their act has stayed frozen. Uh-huh. I see a lot of comics like that who go up, and it's almost like they've been in a coma right up until showtime. Right. And they go out and they're doing, you know, Bill Clinton impressions and things like that.
So that's not ageism. That is just laziness.
That's just staleness.
Yeah, that's like a band that never writes any new songs.
Yes. Right.
You know,
become a nostalgia act. Yeah. And that doesn't work for stand-up.
Because I have found that I can play the old guy on stage and get laughs by talking about what's going on right now.
Right, right.
And they're cool with that because an audience... I'm the sick uncle that they know, or the crazy father with the ankle bracelet on stage.
But people in the gatekeepers, none of them are giving us a sitcom anytime soon.
Because they can't control us.
Well, no, because they look at us and they go, that guy is old. He's not going to appeal
to
18 to 34 or whatever they think the prime demographic is. And they're not giving us sitcom. Maybe you guys both just got sitcom deals, but I'm just saying that in general, in the business, your age is a factor with the gatekeepers.
Yeah, I think there's an emphasis now on they're always looking for who's going to be the next big thing.
Right,
as opposed to who's the person who can deliver now.
Why do they want the next big thing?
Because they see you as an investment. They see it as
they can take credit for it,
and they can put in a little bit of money now that'll pay off a lot later. Mm-hmm. Whereas someone who's good now is just what's happening now, and I don't mean the sequel to What's Happening,
which would be awesome.
Which would be great if they did a What's Happening Now.
Joe DeVito,
yes,
your father was probably not part of the Greatest Generation.
No, he was a little bit. He was born in 46, I believe. So he just
not. Okay, your father.
My father born in 1914.
Wow.
And he served in.
Well, he was a war correspondent in World War II and in Korea and in Vietnam.
Let me read you the obit for a guy who died. Arthur Jackson just died at the age of 90.
Wow.
He was given the recipient for WW2. Medal of Honor. His one-man assault at, I can't pronounce this, Peleliu, against the Japanese. Jackson, 19, was with the 1st Marine Division in the Western Pacific during one of the most grueling battles. In the struggle for Peleliu, his unit was ordered to clear the southern end of the island. And he loaded himself up with grenades. He stormed what they called the pillbox. That's where the And he was hit with automatic fire, but he continued to throw white phosphorus grenades, killing 35 Japanese. Injured, he went on to kill another 200, save the lives of 50 of his fellow soldiers, and was given all the accolades that he deserved.
Wow. Interesting. Here's someone who, in about 3 minutes of their life, accomplished more than I have.
I know. I've only killed like about a dozen Japanese in my time.
Yeah. And that was at a sushi restaurant.
Yes, it was.
I guess the message is, when you look at life, you have to kill Japanese where you can.
Yes, you can.
Don't
you
sleep on
it. You have to. It's very true.
Well, I hate to leave early, but I'm motivated now to stab my dry cleaner.
You'll come back?
I absolutely will.
I didn't have enough time with you.
I know. It wasn't enough. I'm just passing through, unfortunately.
Okay. Come back. Joe DeVito, let's plug some gigs.
Just go to joedevito.com. I know I got coming up next month a week in San Antonio at the Improv there. And
nice.
Always have Long Island stuff. So I got my whole schedule there. And you can at Joe DeVito Comedy on Twitter and Instagram. And,
great.
Got all kinds of other
things
going on. So.
Come back. Will
right
you?
On.
Thank you. I'm sorry we didn't get to feed you.
That's
next
okay.
time. Thank you. Yes. Who? I have my reading glasses on. Who's here? Who is this?
Against my will, obviously.
Oh my God! Look who stopped. God!
Oh, the cats are good.
Oh,
we
good.
Were just talking about them.
Hi.
Hi. How is everyone?
It's good. Buckles.
I stole Alex's car for a few weeks, so I was just returning it begrudgingly.
I'm so glad to see you. You know Buckles?
Yeah.
We did a show together.
What show?
With you.
Yeah.
We did your podcast.
When?
Right here.
Oh, my God.
Is my pudding here?
I'm just pleased that the tables have turned.
Is this clock right or wrong? Are we on Chicago time?
Chicago time.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, how much time do we have?
We'll do another 30 minutes.
Okay. Thank you, Alex. Hi. Let's talk about The Greatest Generation.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Let's talk about...
What have we been talking about? I heard
we were talking about
The
Greatest Generation, and I said to... We had Annie Letterman on the show.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Do you know Annie?
No.
I know her.
And she was talking about her generation's sexual appetite. And I called my mother afterwards.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And started jacking off.
That's my mother you're talking about. I don't jack off to my mother. Mm. I have photographs that I... This is...
Alan, what am I doing here?
So I said, I would rather, I said this to Annie Letterman on my show. I would rather storm the beaches of Omaha Beach, Normandy, than have to try to figure out how to have sex with Annie Letterman. That this
really?
Is a woman,
wow.
I understand D-Day.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
That I understand.
Mm-hmm.
But a woman in her late 20s, I would have no idea how to have sex with them.
Well, that sounds about accurate.
Anyway.
It's like riding a bike in that there's not a woman involved.
And that you would never be in that situation, yes. So that's fine.
I'd more likely be riding a bike than have sex.
Hi.
Hi.
Eliza Schlesinger is on my topic. I'm not bringing this up because you're a woman. Look, toxoplasmosis.
I see.
Republicans under 40 and Eliza Schlesinger, women talking about their ooh-hoos.
Okay.
Eliza Schlesinger tweeted out that women, she could close her eyes, walk into a comedy club, and she could hear every comic talking about their pussies.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
And she's gotten a lot of flack for saying that how dare she be a gatekeeper? How dare she criticize women for talking about their pussies?
Right.
I was hoping to make a ruling. I didn't know you were here, but I had DeVito here. And I have Frank Conniff, and we were going to rule as to whether or not female comics should or should not talk about their pussy on stage. You've kind of thrown me for a loop here by being here.
I think that's a very simple answer to that.
Yeah.
I think anyone or a woman, if they're going to talk about whatever, if they have something funny to say about it, then they should talk about it. If there's a good punchline or a good observation or a funny, even just a dirty, funny thing that's just silly and dirty, then why not? You know, as long as the comedy is there, why wouldn't you talk about it if you had a funny thing to say about it?
Maybe your dad is in the audience?
The stench would be a little strong because my dad's been dead for 40 years. But so many comics work blue, you know, and in fact, a lot of the comics that get HBO specials work blue. You know, so that's a whole separate issue of like, should you work blue because your dad might, because someone's dad or someone who's prudish about it will be in the, that's an issue that applies to any comedian. But the issue of should you, if you're a woman, should you specifically talk about your vagina? Yes. If you have a funny bit about it, of course you should.
Buckles, just start talking.
We got this, Buckles.
So.
Yeah. Yeah, no, please go fuck yourself. Anyways, I don't know. I think the same. If it's funny, then yeah, go ahead. I don't think you should or shouldn't do anything.
I have some Jew jokes that are funny.
Sure, yeah.
That doesn't mean I should be telling them on stage.
You do tell them on stage.
Yeah, here we are.
But I shouldn't be. I mean, I have racist jokes that are funny. Mm-hmm. I have jokes about...
Are they, Feldman? Are they funny?
I have a joke about going to a whorehouse and strangling a hooker and saying, stop me when I get to $300. I know that's funny. It doesn't belong on stage.
Well, that's the thing. But why would a pussy joke be offensive, you know? I mean, maybe a joke about Jews or a joke about black people, it's about their ethnicity and people would be offended by it. What is offensive about talking about a pussy?
There's nothing offensive about it.
Maybe we should, because we have Liz Winstead and Greg Proops on the show in the past couple of weeks talking about a woman's right to choose.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. I have a feeling that the more women talk about their pussies, I'm being serious, the same way men talk about their dicks.
Which they have been every day since I've started doing comedy, and way before then. I started in the 80s comedy boom and heard nothing but dick jokes, a parade of nonstop dick jokes throughout all my years of doing comedy.
Right.
So that's
right.
been happening for a long, long time.
And I think if women talk about their pussy.
And Johnny Carson did dick jokes.
Yes.
He there was innuendo in them, but he did stuff like that. So
right.
I think if women can do jokes about their pussies, I mean this, and this is I'm coming around to this.
Okay.
So this is good news for women because Frank and I are about to issue a ruling as to whether.
Oh, good! Thank God, Feldman said
don't
it's okay.
Crowd me in with you. Like I'm on your team. Or
no, I decide. I decide whether or not women can joke about their pussies or not. It's up to me to decide.
Okay.
And I have an expert witness.
It's not up to me. I just offered an
opinion.
It's
up to me. And we have an expert witness here, Buckles. You've seen a pussy?
I've seen a pussy, yes.
Okay, so I'm going to issue a ruling. I got my robes on.
Great.
I'm beginning to believe that if more and more women talk incessantly about their pussy, we will eventually stop closing abortion clinics. Is that a fair statement?
It's fairly broad.
Yes, it's broad. But what I would agree with is if we can ever get to the point where people are not hung up about sex, we're just talking about it in any context, is just something you talk about because it's a part of life, that would be a very healthy thing. And on the radio show that I do with John Fugelsang, we have people come on who talk about the harm that porn has done to people and then the harm porn has done to younger people because it's all they've learned about sex is just from watching porn. And what
not I... Not to mention snuff videos.
Yeah, well, that's all I learned about it. But I always make up the point that whatever, however bad porn is for young kids growing up watching it and learning about sex from, it's not nearly as bad as learning about sex from religion, which is what my generation and the generations previously
learned
about it from people who the basis of their entire religion was that their Messiah was born, was a virgin birth. That's who we learned about sex from, you know.
Immaculate conception.
Yes, immaculate conception. We learned about sex from people who knew nothing about it and were afraid of it and lived in mortal fear of it. And so as harmful as porn can be, I think that's actually a step forward that people that it leads to a little bit more openness about sex than just the religious repression that we all grew up under.
Now, I don't even understand virgin birth because I'm Jewish.
Uh-huh.
But I thought, well, if it's a virgin, I thought when my wife went into labor, I dropped my pants, whipped out my dick, and tried to have sex with her because I didn't want her to have a virgin birth.
That makes no sense.
Well, it makes no sense, but the term virgin birth, I thought, you're supposed to have sex, so it's not a virgin birth.
Right. If you haven't had sex and you give birth,
I see. Okay.
Sure.
So asking somebody to blow you while she's giving birth.
Would be considered of poor taste.
Yeah. That would be bad. That's the wrong. That has nothing to do with the virgin birth.
Yeah, no, I not that I know of, but like I said, I grew up learning about it all from religion, so I don't know anything.
Let's get back to talking about pussy.
I thought I was.
Do you think a mother, this is just, I'm throwing this out there, if my mother comes and sees me talking about my dick.
If your mother comes, no, never mind.
You're talking about a woman who I put an ear horn in her ass so she could fart louder. This is the woman you are making?
Yes, it is.
That's a reference to a joke Alex came up with that I sneaked. You gave me that joke. You said, do a joke about your mother being hard of hearing.
Alex, and, you're scruffy.
And I had to put an ear horn in her ass so she could hear her own farts. That's actually funny. I fixed it.
I fixed it.
I fixed your joke.
There's no time for editing.
The problem was she complained about how loud I was chewing.
Can you, do you think a mother going to see her son telling dick jokes is more comfortable than a father going to see his daughter talking about her pussy? I'm going to just make a sweeping generalization. I'm going to say a father is more likely to be uncomfortable watching his daughter talk about her pussy than a mother is talking about her son's
That
dick.
Might be true, but you know what? If you have a certain kind, that shouldn't even be an issue, because if you have a certain kind of act and your parents are a certain kind of way, the whole thing is tell them, Mom, Dad, don't come to see my show because you're going to be upset.
Don't come
to see my show.
I feel like parents are very just open about, I mean, at least my generation, I don't, you don't run into too many parents that are really uptight about that kind of thing.
Yeah, that's probably a current generation kind of thing, because my and my parents' generation was uptight about everything.
My mother was like, you know, wouldn't even let me masturbate at the table.
Terrible. Good, kind of repressive household that you grow up in. I mean,
but it was very Victorian. What are your thoughts?
I mean, I just think that we...
I don't care. So anyway...
Oh, God. All right. I'm good. All right, Alex. Can I get out?
No, what are your thoughts?
No, I just think that my generations, a lot of our parents don't care. They support that kind of a thing. Even if it did make them uncomfortable, they would feign supporting, you know, a supporting attitude about it. But
I was talking to Greg Proops about white men who are poor and they are told to check their white privilege, even though they're convinced they have no white privilege. I'm leading to pussy. I'm going to get to pussy in a second. Can you understand how a white man doesn't understand
their own privilege? Yes.
How he should check his own privilege if he's broke, living out of his car? Why should he have sympathy for anybody other than himself? Can you understand that?
I can definitely understand that. I feel like that just being a white male, it's just your life is just naturally easier.
But if you're a white man who is all the jobs have disappeared, he's broke, he's about to lose his house. Mm-hmm. Can you understand why he's turning a blind eye to the plight of everybody other than himself?
I think anybody would be. Yeah, I mean, I guess I could see where they're coming from, but not really.
Because I think with a lot of like white people who like people who voted for Trump, who are in economic distress, and that might be why they voted for Trump. But there's a sense with them that their problems, it's more important that they're having their problems, that the fact that they're hurting financially is a much bigger deal than the fact that other people are hurting financially. Yeah. Because they're white men, they're not supposed to be hurting financially. You know, so and also the media treat, you know, the New York Times every week they do an article where they go to a rural town to talk to white voters who were still support Trump because they're white, their opinion on things is looked at as more important than anybody else's. And so that's why and so they get more attention, and it's considered a bigger deal to a lot of people, the fact that these white men are in distress.
Okay, so I'm talking about moving the ball forward politically and socially. Obama is of the mind that you have to understand the people who are sometimes oppressing you. Can you understand how a certain generation of men and women would be uncomfortable hearing a comic talking about her pussy on stage?
I can understand why somebody might be uncomfortable about it, but if it makes you uncomfortable, then leave.
Yeah, don't go to the show. You have a host of entertainment options available to you.
Yeah.
Thanks to our friend Jeff Bezos that we were just talking about. You can stay home and watch Amazon. You can watch the Bells of St. Mary on Amazon Prime. You know, you don't have to go to a comedy club and hear dick and vagina jokes if that's not what you're into. Majority, it seems to me, of people who go to comedy clubs, who they've grown up watching HBO specials, they've grown up watching Comedy Central, watching South Park or whatever, they are watching Chris Rock, They go to a club expecting this kind of thing. They have no problem with it. That's the comedy club audience. So if one or two people who are parents or whatever are uptight with it, and there always are those people in every comedy show. There's always a couple people who don't know what they've gotten themselves in for, and they get up and walk out. But an entertainer has the right to gear his material towards his... towards an audience that wants to be entertained. You shouldn't have to think about those people that are uptight about it.
Can you understand? Let me have Buckles answer this.
I did answer that.
But let me ask you this question. Let me ask you this question.
What?
Let me ask you this question.
Oh, my God. Uh-huh.
Can you understand how some people fear that vulgarians are informing the entire conversation?
You mean like Trump?
Well, yes, mm-hmm. that when people say whatever they want to say with mm-hmm. no filter, they talk about their pussy, their dick, their bowel movements, you know, everything that I do on the show, that it informs what goes on in the classroom, what goes on at the dinner table, and that it's the end of civilization, that civil discourse breaks down when you have superstars making millions of dollars talking about their cock, their pussy, and their bowel movements.
Right.
Can you understand why some people might say, let's keep these things as taboo and fight it so we'll force people to talk about more important things? Or maybe talking about the uterus and your vagina is important. Is it important to talk about the vagina?
I think so. I think especially now that we're actually getting threatened to get some of our rights taken away, and that we might not have access to abortion clinics or not even abortion clinics, but the fact that we might not. I mean, if Planned Parenthood goes away, I have no idea how I'm going to be able to afford.
You know, Mike Pence is probably the epitome of a person who thinks our culture has gone to hell and that there's the lack of civility and that people are talking about taboo subjects that we'd be much better off without. But Mike Pence is Donald Trump's vice president and supports any number of things that I consider to be vulgar and offensive, and that mm-hmm. and that. So it's like, who gets to decide that?
Yeah, I actually had a discussion with a group of people like a couple weeks ago. It was brought to my attention that recently in like grade schools, middle schools, and high schools, they're now telling girls that they're not allowed to wear yoga pants to school. Because they're like too tight and form fitting, but they're like workout pants. And so they're saying that they can't wear these pants at school anymore because it's too distracting for the boys.
Is this a public school or a private school?
Public school.
Public school. Okay.
Which I thought, I mean, in my opinion, and I disagreed with everyone at the table, in my opinion, it's like, why are we teaching the girls that their bodies are these like sexual, they're sexual things and they're meant to be hidden so that we don't distract, you know, Beavis and Butthead and they're fucking, you know, and on the football team. Like, heaven forbid we distract those boys from getting good grades. But heaven forbid we don't teach those kids that these girls are just wearing workout clothes and they need to focus on their work.
This is very interesting to me because I had conversations about what some of my daughters wore. Of course, mm-hmm. it didn't matter what I thought. Can you understand?
Still the same.
Can you understand how a father... I agree with everything you're saying. I'm just asking you, can you understand how a father might not want his daughter to dress a certain way? And is that wrong that the father says, you know, maybe you should wear this blanket with
holes
in it?
You should wear this fully, this
well,
footy
as a parent,
pajamas.
You have a right. That's your purview. That's your right as someone who's bringing up a kid who isn't an adult yet to impose your views on them. That's your right. I think it's a different thing with a school with something like yoga pants, which is so, they're just making it dirty.
They're sexualizing it,
yeah.
But I mean, is it possible? I'm just asking.
Oh, for like the parents to be?
Is it, do you think it's fair for somebody to say to a young girl, you're showing too much skin?
I mean, in some contexts, I guess, yes, for like really little girl, like especially like there's a bunch of stuff now with like Snapchat and Musical.ly and all these different things. And some of these girls are like 8 and 12 and they look like they're 17. They wear so much makeup. They wear no clothes.
Do you have a right as a parent?
As a parent, yes, absolutely. Yes.
As a public, no. It's none of my business.
As a politician, if I'm running for office.
Absolutely not.
Okay, I'm running for office.
Absolutely not.
But let me tell you what I would say, and okay. I believe this. Okay?
Uh-huh.
And this is what I said. You have choices in your life on how you want to be seen.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want it to be respected for your brain or your body? Do you want to draw attention to your body or to your brain?
Hmm.
And that goes for men and women.
Right. But why is it that when a girl gets dressed up or that like when
it's a double standard, I agree.
No, but I'm just saying like why like it's the same thing happens to me. Like sometimes I just like I just want to wear a skirt because it's hot outside and I feel good in a skirt. But then automatically it's like, oh, somebody wanted to get their legs seen today. It's like, no, I wore a fucking skirt because I'm hot.
Okay. Can you understand? Let me ask.
It's very.
I wear short pants every day in the summer.
And I always look at your legs,
yes,
Frank.
Yes, I know. They're pretty, pretty sweet. But
are men?
But if a woman wants to wear shorts and it's hot out and. As a man, if her legs are nice, men are going to look at it. But it's really up to the men to they can look at it fine, but to not be all salacious about it.
Absolutely.
You know? And a woman and an intelligent woman who's attractive shouldn't have to think, oh well, I want to be known for my brain, so I'm going to
cover up.
So I'm going to wear baggy long pants out because otherwise people won't respect me for my. I mean, that's bullshit.
Okay,
you know?
Okay, hang on for one second. I agree with everything you're saying. I'm just an old man.
Mm-hmm. You're younger than I am.
Are men rapists?
Are people rapists?
Are men rapists?
Sure.
When you put men in prison with other men,
uh-huh.
Do they rape each other?
Yes.
Do women rape men?
Yes.
But it's not as prevalent as men raping women.
No, but it certainly doesn't not happen.
It's an anomaly.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. Men are rapists, correct?
Not all men. That's a
but men,
sweeping generalization,
no,
Alex.
But men are rapists. Men are rapists. Women, for all intents and purposes, are not.
Uh-huh.
Is that a fair statement?
We'll be back in a minute with more of the Andrea Dworkin Show. she believed intercourse was rape. Just whatever, you know.
And 20 years ago, I would have said it's not. Now I'm enlightened.
No, I mean, yeah, okay. Go ahead.
Okay, if men are rapists, uh-huh. which they are,
mm-hmm.
do men murder women out of jealousy?
Men murder women out of jealousy?
Yes. Are men dangerous?
It's been known to happen.
Are men more dangerous than women?
No.
Yes. I think so.
I don't
physically.
Think so. Physically, yes. Physically,
oh, okay.
yes.
Physically. So when you're walking down the street
uh-huh.
and you see a woman,
mm-hmm.
do you feel threatened?
No.
When you see a man, is there a possible threat?
I mean, the context really depends. But yeah, if it's like the street in the middle of the night and I see a guy, I will feel more threatened.
Right. So men are more dangerous than women in every way. That's a fact.
I feel like you're like backing me into this weird corner.
Yeah.
And I don't know where I'm going.
Appropriately enough.
Who knows more about men being dangerous than men? Aren't men entitled to be a little concerned about men around women? Especially older men. Can you understand how...
Sure, I can see what you're saying, but why are we teaching... But the second we tell that little girl to change her pants at school...
Mm-hmm.
We are informing that little boy that women around him need to change to make him feel like he doesn't have to fuck
something. Well, it's not an either or.
That's insane.
It's not an either or. You conceivably can do both.
But I'm just saying, you're immediately teaching the little girl that she's a sexualized object, and you're teaching the little boys that that's okay, and that by her wearing something different, she's like coming on to him.
It's the what is she? I agree with you on that. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
It's a little. There is. Okay.
Move on.
What is, oh my God, this is important. So can you understand how Eliza Schlesinger maybe is saying, if you're going to talk about your pussy, talk about abortion, talk about, I mean,
But my disagreement with that is if, If you have a, and I said this before, if you have a really silly joke about your pussy that's just silly and funny, go ahead and fucking do it. I mean, not every joke, even if it's about, you know, it, why should women have this burden, or women comedians have this burden put on them that, like, oh, if you're going to talk about your vagina, make it a, make sure that it's a point about abortion or about women's control over their own bodies. I mean, and even if you do, even if you make it a point about abortion, if you're a comedian, make sure it's really funny. And also, if you have a really funny thing to say about your pussy that's just goofy, and go ahead and say it. Your job is to make people laugh. And if you think it's something funny, then go ahead and do it.
Just because people are laughing at something doesn't mean they're right to be laughing at it. Right? We have standards.
I don't. I just, my whole thing.
What
and
about
I
Andrew
do,
Dice Clay? I can imagine.
But you know what? But I worked with Andrew Dice Clay in the 1980s before he was a star, and there were parts of his act, even then that was really
funny.
Jingoistic and disturbing, but there were other parts of his act that were cartoonish and hilarious, I thought, at the time. He made me laugh.
Okay, and do you approve of his jingoism?
No, I don't. I don't. But that's his decision to do that. I don't, it's not something.
Is it dangerous? Is jingo?
It can be, yes. It can be dangerous. And I think that when he became a gigantic star, he represented something very disturbing. But what I was about to say about my act, I mean, I do political jokes. I do jokes about all kinds of things. But my goal, regardless of what I'm talking about, is I want to make people spit their drinks through their nose. I don't care. I care about that I'm making some kind of higher point about anything. I just want to make people laugh.
Okay, but do you ever wonder why people are laughing at something?
I mean, it's worth wondering about sometimes, but I don't. If I'm laughing at something, I don't wonder about. Sometimes I know that stuff that makes me laugh, it might be appealing to not necessarily the higher angels of my nature, but I fucking love laughing, and I love it when people say something that makes me laugh.
Can it be wrong?
I love it when I make people laugh.
Can it be wrong to be laughing at something?
No.
Yes.
I don't think so.
Absolutely.
I think that there's.
Have you ever been laughed at?
I've heard, you know, doing comedy in the 80s in the comedy boom and on one-nighters. I heard stuff that people laughed at that was reprehensible to me. That people were laughing at it and comics.
Are they wrong?
Comics who got big laughs, who were horrible, who were hacky, and who had a really and in the 80s and it's in the mainstream comedy clubs, the one-nighters that I worked. Misogyny, homophobia, you know, was just rampant in comedians.
Also, the first 20 minutes of the show.
Sam Kinison was extremely misogynistic, extremely homophobic in his act. I guess later on he might have grown a little bit.
Right.
But that stuff did disturb me. And for my personal choice, I didn't laugh at it. I didn't think it was funny.
Right.
I don't revere Sam Kinison the way other people do.
I agree with you.
Because of that.
Whereas Andrew Dice Clay was an act.
Well, parts of Andrew Dice's Clay's act were like what Dennis Miller said about it, Fonzie with Tourette's. It was like this cartoonish character who was like an over-the-top sexist. But in parts of his act, it was cartoonist, and it had irony to it. It was as if he was making fun of that kind of character.
Whereas Kinison meant it.
Whereas Kinison seemed to mean it, yeah. So there is stuff that other people laugh at and that other people do as comedy that, yeah, I find it's horrible. But that's a personal choice that people make. But my goal as a comedian is I just want to make people laugh like crazy. And there are people who object to what I do. There are people who are Mystery Science Theater fans who don't like that I do political comedy, who think that it's a wrong direction for me. And I'm just okay with them thinking that way. I'm going to do what I'm going to do either way.
Do you think Ann Coulter poisons minds?
I don't. Her own mind is poisoned. I don't know.
She's a lunatic.
But the problem isn't Ann Coulter as much as the people who give her a form, the people who normalize her, the people like Chris Matthews who put her on who put her on their show, the Today Show, they put her on, and it's like, well, now let's hear Ann Coulter's point of view. You don't agree with everything she says, and she sure is outrageous, but let's hear what her point of view is.
And let's go ahead and hear what she has to say anyways.
Yeah, it completely normalizes hate speech. And in our culture, in a democracy, you're allowed to normalize hate speech. Every right to do it. I don't agree with it.
After the shooting Wednesday last week, Bill Kristol was on MSNBC, and I tweeted out, MSNBC stopped putting Bill Kristol on MSNBC.
Yes.
Because I think he poisons minds, and I think he's a war criminal.
Yes.
Do I have a right to criticize his speech?
Yes, of course.
Sure, of course you do.
And discuss his speech.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they have the right to put him on, but my thing that I'm always ranting about the people who run MSNBC and the people who run CNN is that they're not patriots. They don't care about their country. They just care about putting these people on that are going to be provocative. And these are the people who are really demeaning our culture. These are the people. It's not the comedians or any of the artists who are demeaning our culture. It's the people in the boardrooms who are normalizing people like Donald Trump and Bill Kristol and Hugh Hewitt and all of these and Alex Jones and all these crazy people.
I don't want Alex.
Who have a right to say whatever they want, but you don't have to. They have an audience for what they do. You don't have to put them on them.
NBC is wrong for giving Megyn Kelly, who has a history.
They're wrong for hiring Megyn Kelly in the first place. They're wrong for giving her $17 million. They're wrong for giving her a show. And they're wrong for letting her put Alex Jones on her show. They're wrong all the way down the line.
So why then?
But they have a right to do it.
They have a right to do it, but we have a right to speak up.
To speak up against
Does
it.
Does Eliza Schlesinger not only have a right, but a responsibility to say, I can close my eyes in any comedy club and hear the same jokes about a woman's pussy? In other words,
no.
She doesn't have a right to say
no,
that.
No, I strongly feel that, political commentators, crazy people, whatever, you have every right to say, you shouldn't be saying this. And everyone can say whatever they want about anybody's. But I think that when you start telling comedians what to say, I think that is dangerous.
She just has an opinion about it. She's expressing an opinion.
But I'm just saying that when you start trying to, regulate what comedians are saying, when people start saying, oh, I don't feel like what they said was in good taste, and then people start saying that comedians shouldn't be saying a certain thing, I think that is very dangerous.
Is it? What about my saying I don't believe that Bill Kristol should be allowed on MSNBC?
I think that's different.
Why?
Because it's political. It's politics. I feel like that's different. When you're going on Louis C.K. isn't going on a political platform and saying something. He's in a comedy space. And I feel like comedy and those comedy clubs, those are sacred. They should be able to say whatever you want to
really
say.
Sacred?
Yes, I do. I feel
are they sacred?
If you start telling comedians what to say and not to say, we are the frogs of this environment. If you kill the frogs, the environment will die.
Okay.
Because this is an open forum for people to say what people are actually feeling, and it's okay to laugh.
But don't I have a right? Doesn't Eliza have a right to suggest.
She's right to suggest. She doesn't have a right to
say. She's not calling for government censorship. She's saying to women, is it wrong to say to women? Let me, as a Jew, because we self-police.
Uh-huh.
The Jews self-police. They do.
Mm-hmm.
I've said this a million times on the show. You will not see a Jew up on stage reinforcing stereotypes that are dangerous, that feed into the Holocaust. We self-police.
Mm-hmm.
Is self-policing wrong? Is it wrong for a woman to say, hey, you know, talk about your vaginas, but...
Isn't part of... Because I'm only hearing about this the first time from you. I didn't follow the whole thing. I guess it was on Twitter with Eliza.
I think what Eliza is saying
because
is...
Because what might be the reaction to it is that maybe women comedians just... They feel under siege anyway, and it might be upsetting to them that another woman is coming after them when we live in an environment now with Donald Trump as president and with Bill Cosby getting a mistrial, all this stuff that, that like women feel really under siege today. And so it might be just that they were upset that another female was
it's like the N-word.
Was adding fuel to the fire.
It's
but not knowing anything about it, I would say
then feel free to speak.
I feel she has every right, like anyone, to say on Twitter whatever their opinion is.
Right. It's like the N-word. Yes. People.
Where's this going?
Well, because after Michael Richards, a couple of African Americans swore off the N-word. They said, you know what? We shouldn't say it. Mm-hmm. Do African American. Paul Mooney said, that's it, I'm done with the N-word.
And also, some said they weren't going to watch Fridays anymore.
Even I barely get. Michael Richards was on Fridays.
Yes.
I have to annotate my show. That was in the 80s. Do African-American comedians have the right to issue edicts saying, no more N-word?
I don't think so.
I don't feel like I have the right position.
Does Paul Mooney, as an elder statesman, have the right to say, you know what, we should lay off the
N-word? He has the right to say he's not going to say it anymore.
Right.
You know, and I think his Ice Cube said on Bill Maher that it's our word, we can say it. Sorry, white people, you can't have it. It's our word, but we can say it.
Do you think African Americans are conflicted about the use of the N-word?
I don't know.
Yes, they are.
I
speak for all African Americans.
I think Alex is losing it.
Yeah, we gotta wrap up.
Okay, I think all African Americans. We're gonna wrap it up. I think all African Americans are conflicted about the use of the N-word, and I think women are conflicted. I don't think all women are on the same page when it comes to pussy jokes.
No, but I don't think all men are on the same page about dick jokes.
I think we are.
I don't think so.
I think we go,
I think
who cares?
That's a sweeping generalization.
That's what I traffic in on this show. All I'm saying is, if a Nazi, and I'm wrapping up, this is my closing. Hang on for one second.
If a Nazi is his closing comment.
If a Nazi rounds you up and takes you and your family, your Jewish family, to a concentration camp and removes your clothes and your hair.
And the train is going at 35 miles an hour.
And you're being put in the oven. Try to understand his point of view. That's all I'm saying.
Ew.
That's how I was raised.
All right, folks. Try to understand. We all need to go take a shower.
As you're being put into an oven by a Nazi.
I think anyone listening to this show would agree, this must never happen again.
That's how I was raised. Try to understand the other side. Okay. Frank, let's plug some gigs.
I'll be in July. Go to themadsareback.com and the Mads Are Back Facebook page. Find out about all our Traceable, you and I, our upcoming gigs.
Why don't we do this? Before we go, tell everybody what you're doing and how they reach you very quick. Not quickly, just you'll get the last word.
Go to my Twitter, Frank Conniff, Facebook Frank Conniff, and you'll find out about all my gigs, including Columbus, Ohio, and Denver, Colorado in July.
Woohoo.
And Buckles.
I'm working on Search Party right now.
What
so
is
I
that?
Guess it's a show that airs on TBS. It should be airing sometime in October, so keep your eye out for that.
That was on already, though,
yes,
right?
The season two. We're shooting season two right now. Cool. Yeah. And then I have a show with Lacey Jekka, We're Fighting, and that will be at the Knitting Factory on September 2nd.
And how's Colin's show coming along?
It's good. Alex just saw it, 2 weeks ago, Alex?
Yeah.
It's good.
Colin Firth, one of the funniest actors.
I'm going to kill myself. Good night.
You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.